Oh, how he loves me. Yeah. see that announcement in your bulletin? Right in the middle of the page. On the back of your bulletin, there's a special announcement. Cry Out America. In the Book of Joel, it says this, declare a holy fast, call a sacred assembly, summon the elders and all who live in the land to the house of the Lord and cry out to the Lord. At 9 o'clock in the morning, tomorrow is September the 11th. Amen. We'll never forget 9/11. Tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock in the chapel, we're asking as many of you can come. And let's pray for 1 hour. 1 hour. That's all. Remember Jesus asked his disciples, can you not stay awake for 1 hour and pray? Let's stay awake, let's come to the house, and let's cry out. Let's pray for America, around the world, many are being persecuted, many are suffering. We know the situation right here in our own country with the hurricane, so let's come together in a unified effort and cry out for America. Amen. Hope to see you there. Ushers, will you please come at this time? We're going to receive God's tithes and our offerings. I'm going to ask Pastor Wade if he will come, please. And pray and lead us in prayer as we bring God's tithes and offerings to him. Let us pray. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, our God, our Lord, our Shepherd, your faithful God. Your provision is great to us. Now is the time to bring your tithes, to give our offering. You are worthy, Lord. Everything we have is yours. Silver and gold is unto you, Lord. Give it to expand your kingdom, to meet the need of your house. Bless your children as they are giving, Lord. Bless them abundantly. Open doors for your children. Let them get financial breakthrough. Thank you for what you are doing in our life. We pray and believe in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And everyone says, Amen.
Thank you.
glad he's alive. Amen. Praise the Lord. He's not dead. He's not bad. He's not in the tomb, but we serve a risen God. Amen. Let's stand and move about and greet someone. Let them know it's good to see them in God's house this morning. Amen. Okay, thank you very much. Please find your seats. which is a great, great program to reach people around the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Before I introduce our speaker, I want to say that I had a great trip to Burma, and it's a long ways, it's halfway around the world. Matter of fact, it's 11 o'clock at night there now. 11 o'clock in the day here. But I arrived about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. They said, we want you to speak at the Bible school tonight. So I spoke that night at the Bible school. Next day, we had a business meeting gathered together with the officials of the school and also the builder. And we met for about 1 hour. And they asked me if I liked the plan that they had to build the dormitory. I said, looks great. And so I said, go ahead and do it. That afternoon, they were out laying it off. So I preached that night to the Bible school, 170 boys and 70 girls. Once again, the next day, we had a groundbreaking ceremony. We broke ground and that building is now underway. Amen. Give the Lord a big hand. I've never seen a building program go so fast. They were just finishing the men's dormitory, and now they're starting to be 200 beds that will house the girls for the Bible College in Burma. So we're grateful for that. 6 months from now, we're going back for the dedication. It's supposed to be ready in 6 months. And it's the second semester there for their college. They will get out in the end of the year. In January, February, March, and April, there will be no school. Then the girls will come back and they're dormitory ready to move into it. And Brother Sam Johnson and whoever wants to go along, I hope to take my entire family there for the dedication of dedicate that dormitory to my wife, Lois Jean Comer. Amen. Thank you so much. The beds are 200 beds. They're $1,000 a piece. It will cost us $215,000 in order to build it, which is a great, great investment in the kingdom of God for now and for the future in Burma. You know, there's great persecution of the church in Burma. They're fleeing by the hundreds over into Bangladesh to escape the persecution that is going on in that country. And Sam Johnson will be back the end of October. Once again, we'll present that project and hope that many of you will help us out to make it possible by the end by next May, when they get the building finished, we'll have it paid for. How many believe we can? Can you say amen? Praise God. So begin thinking about. But today is one day to feed the world. Here's a book that we have out on the desk. Your next 24 hours, one day of kindness can change everything. Written by Hal Donaldson, who is the head of Convoy of Hope. He and his two brothers started it several years back. And today it's one of the greatest programs to reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Every place we give food and water, we give the gospel of Jesus Christ. And literally thousands are coming to know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior through this compassion ministry. So we thank God for Convoy of Hope. And today, to speak to us for this special day, and I pray that you plan to give only one day's wages today. At the close of our brother's message, we're going to receive that offering and ask every one of you will to give one day's wages. That's all. To feed the entire world, and we feed literally thousands and thousands of kids every day. And today, with the great tragedies taking place in our own country, there's further need for the ministry of Convoy of Hope. My daughter was in Texas. She had 8 inches of water in her house. My brother was in Florida. Their house is flooded out. Their business is flooded out. And today there's very few churches in Florida having church. But thank God that you and I are able to gather today. Can you say amen? And before our speaker comes, let's pray for those in these disaster areas. We do that. Everybody, just call out to the Lord. Ask God to come and help them. Lord, we pray that you would move in a special way. Pray, Lord, for the pastors today that are not able to have church. For those who have had to flee their homes. lest damage come to them. Lord, we pray that you would bring our country together in a way that it's never come together before. That we might accomplish the purpose of God. Help us to realize that you said, when all people cry unto you and humble themselves in prayer, you will hear from heaven. You will forgive our sins and heal our nation. Lord, let healing come to America again. Make the Church of Jesus Christ great all over the world, we pray. We thank you for what you're going to do in your wonderful name. And everybody said, amen. Home Guards have been missionaries for 32 years. We've been big supporters of them in the many ministries that they've had. Now, Brother Terry's heading up Convoy of Hope in Europe and bringing together the International Church in that area. Brother Terry, welcome back to Water Life. Yes. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. Are you having fun, or am I having fun by myself? I am loving it here. I have to tell you, loving it for many reasons. Now, I bet you when people say, this feels like, how do they generally answer that? Feels like heaven. And they're right. And I concur, but for me, it also feels like home. Because my wife and I have been doing international church ministry in Europe for 32 years. When I, back in 1988, I started an international church in Rome. And out of that church, while I was there 10 years, we planted 15 other churches led by Filipino leaders. Now in Italy, we have 61 Filipino churches all over Italy born out of that church in Rome. Can you say amen? E c'è la minima un amico qua che parla italiano. Champion, vero? Champion's my buddy who speaks Italian. So, we always speak Italian together. I love speaking Italian. I don't have not even a gocciatino di sangue italiano. Not even a drop of blood, but I speak Italian and I love it. Now, my wife is all Italian. Her grandfather was an immigrant. And so I got married the day before I turned 20. I have been married for 43 years. I will take your applause, I'll take money, I'll take a medal. I deserve them all. The truth is about being made an Italian wife, and it is great to be made 43 years, but what you should know is that Italian wives do not believe in divorce in any case. So, but unfortunately, they do believe in murder. So really, what choice did I have? I'm sorry Ruthie can't be here. You would love her. She's a wonderful lady. Firebrand followed me all over the world, and I'm grateful for her. But I love what God is doing around the world. I believe international churches are a prophetic expression to the earth, to let the world know what church should really look like. I was telling Pastor beforehand, I think it's wonderful to come into a place and when I led international churches, we always had one service together every week. We never separated ourselves on Sunday morning. We worship together, and it's fantastic. So I'm looking forward. I know no matter how long the services go, you guys are going to be in those seats and ready. I'm not going to test you on that, but I know it's true. And I'm grateful for what God is doing to international churches. Pastor Clover, again, thank you so much for being a leader for us. Back in the 80s, when I didn't even know what an international church looked like, someone said, you need to talk to Wendell Culver because he can help you. Every time I've talked to Pastor Culver, he's helped me. And thank you for being a champion and a leader for so many of us. My generation, those before me, and lots of guys coming after me, Pastor Culver. God bless you. I think we should honor him. He's a wonderful man of God who we love dearly. Well, I'm happy to be here on what I know is a very special day. This is sort of a day that's a sanctified day. Sanctified means it's simply been set apart for a high and holy purpose. Now, every Lord's Day is special, certainly so, but this day is exceptionally special because you have come intending already, Pastor Culver's been talking to you about it, you've already intended to come and make an investment into doing something that can change the world. And I want to thank you for caring about those whose names you may never know and whose faces you may never see, but they are nonetheless the sons and daughters of God, and they stand in great peril. I can't imagine that you could choose a better partner than Convoy of Hope. Because our Convoy of Hope lives every day doing everything they can to make a difference. You should know today that around the globe, Convoy is on the ground trying to manage four separate disasters. We have guys in the ground in Texas. We have guys in the ground in Florida. We have guys on the ground in the Caribbean, and we have guys on the ground in South Asia. Now absolutely. Thank God for that. And the guys in South Asia are managing a crisis that's been going on for a long time. We don't hear a lot about it, but South Asia, Northern India, Bangladesh, and Nepal had exceptionally difficult monsoons this year, which led them with great floods, and it left them with mudslides, and thousands of people have lost their lives, and thousands more live in misery today. And we're trying, in spite of all the other things that have since happened, we're not giving up on South Asia. We're going to stand the game there and stand the game everywhere else. And we're just waiting to find out how we can help Mexico with the earthquake. That's what Convoy does. Convoy has made an exceptional commitment to be the kind of organization that shows up when everybody else is on their way out, Convoy's on their way in. And they're known for two things. They stay longer than most orgs ever stay, and they embed everything they do with the local church. Can you say amen to that? So we can help you when you're in trouble, but Convoy connects you to a living spiritual community. So long after our trucks are gone, the work on the ground remains. I'll tell you just a couple of quick facts about Convoy beyond the four disasters on the ground in four different places today as we sit here. Convoy's also involved in a refugee crisis that is consuming our world in many places. You know, we have a big refugee stream that generally comes and makes its way through Europe for one reason or another. 66 million people are living away from their homelands today, refugees. There's a slow developing crisis in Sudan that has forced out of just utter famine people out of Sudan. They're landing in largely Uganda. The refugee camp in Uganda has 272,000 people in it. They're housed in a private piece of land. They get a 30 by 30 piece of space and some materials to start building a little hut to cover themselves with. And Convoy's on the ground doing something there. I remember standing in Calais, France, which is just on the border of the tunnels that take you into England. And the refugees wanted to get out of the countries they came from passage through Europe, and their desire was to get to Great Britain. And so what happened was, of course, it wasn't easy free passage. So they got blocked in Calais, and I remember standing in Calais, mud everywhere. The water, the showers you had for a shower was water sort of blew up on your face. You washed with your hand and the back of your head, and you kind of wiped off, and that was it. They lived in houses made of plastic. I remember standing there looking at this camp that was growing at that point daily, looking up on the berm on the road. There was about 3 or 4 French military officers who were part of the police system there, but they were standing there looking down on the camp. They didn't have aggression in mind, but you didn't know that because they stood there with stern looks on their faces, and they were holding semi-automatic weapons. My friend, Michael McNamee, an Irish guy, maybe you know him. Michael says, "What do you think, Terry?" I looked around and I said, "What I think? I think this place is suspended agony. They can't go forward. They can't go back. They have no idea how to manage tomorrow. They have guys standing up on a berm with weapons who could easily just say, 'We're going to clear this camp and do it today,' and they'd have to scurry to save their lives. Convoys there. We're feeding 160,000 children every single day around the world." "We're doing that in almost 1,000 program centers in 11 different nations. You should know every time we have a program center, it means we meet our students, our children there. These are children who would not have a hot meal. I've been there many, many, many times. They ask them just to verify, 'How many of you already eaten today?' No one's hand goes up. 'How many of you ate yesterday?' No one's hand goes up. 'How many had breakfast?' No one's hand goes up. They're coming to our feeding centers, and when we're in school, they're with us. So 5 days a week we're feeding them. The other 2 days we're trying to send portions home with them for them and their families back home. But every single day, 5 days a week, 160,000 kids are eating a hot meal, and before they eat that meal, they're participating in some kind of gospel presentation. I've been in the Philippines for those little kids to sing their songs and raise their little hands and pray, and then they have their meal. But every time we put food in someone's mouth, we make sure that we talk to them about this gospel opportunity. Guys, put up my first slide, if you will. What I want to talk to you about today is this idea of creating redemptive opportunities. That's what Convoy does. Convoy makes a decision to step into places where no one else wants to go and do everything they can to create some kind of gospel opportunity. Now, you know what I know, that people who are in very difficult places are often the ones who are most anxious to hear a message about life. It's people who are in a transition, people who are walking through a time of trouble, people who are living under great tension. The people I work with in international churches are people like that. They're on a journey. They know what they left was not bearable, but they don't know what they're going to find as they keep moving forward. And on this journey, I can't tell you how many times we have taken people who had no real knowledge of Christ. Some come from countries that were gospel hardened. Some from countries with very little gospel opportunity. And we get a chance to have them come through our cities and towns and in Europe, and we use every single one of those moments to make a gospel presentation. So it is a Convoy of Hope. Everything they do is tied back to the gospel moment. And I'm so proud of Convoy for that. I'm grateful that they live like that. And the stories that can be told are numerous. I don't have time to tell a lot of stories tonight. I will just tell you a little bit. Tonight we meet at 6 o'clock. And I love to tell stories, but I also love to honor the clock and be faithful to finish what I need to finish. If you come back tonight, we'll try to tell you as many stories as you want to hear. I might tell a couple in the service, but I want you to leave with one piercing image. So I'm going to show you a video. This video is a story of a young boy whose name is Baraka. You'll be stricken by the tragic circumstances he lives in when you see where he lives. You'll be sad to know the pain he's had to endure as a little boy already. But you'll be overjoyed and thankful that Convoy's on the ground, and more than that, that Baraka has found treasure that's changed his life. Let's see the video.
Thank you.
quite a young man, don't you agree? And brought the story, and there could be many, but focus on this one because it illustrates many things. It's the value of convoy. It's the beauty of what you're giving to today. It's why this one day matters so that we can continue to reach and touch and make a difference everywhere we can. But also speaks about something that I want you to take home with you, a reality, a thought that I want you to carry in your hearts as you go out of here. Now, what convoy does, and if I could say, I'm often asked to explain convoy, and here's how I say it in three short statements. Convoy has made a decision that they're going to serve people who have been made fragile by life's difficult circumstances. Secondly, they decided that they're going to stand with those people who, out of their fragility, become desperate. And more than that, they're intending to shape the heart of the church and turn it towards compassion. Those are powerful priorities to live by. They're not easy, and they're not cheap, but they are eternal. And what you're doing today is going to make a big difference. What I want to talk to you about, guys, just go ahead and stay ahead of me on the slides so that people can have them if they're taking notes. We're going to talk about creating a redemptive opportunity. Now, here's what I want to just talk to you about. I don't know about you, I met Jesus in 1970, a month before I was going to be 16 years old. And when I met Jesus, I was all in. I pushed everything his way from the very beginning. And so what I understood was that God had very specific plans for me. God wanted to do something through me. I didn't have all the language at that time, but I understood that God expected me to live in such a way that I would find opportunity or find the possibility to create redemptive moments, that I would do something to create redemptive opportunities everywhere I went. I didn't understand that, honestly, early on. I remember in the September after I met Jesus in July, I'm going to school with my buddies, the same guys I'd known throughout high school and junior high. And so I'm sitting in my car, I drive up to school, I put my car in park, I look straight ahead, not my rearview mirror, and I say to my buddies, guys, I know that I brought all of us into some circumstances and situations where we did things we should not have done. I feel terrible because deep in my heart I knew it was wrong, but I did it anyway. But everything's changed for me. I made a decision to give my life to Christ. And I'm not going to do anything that we did last year, not one single thing. It's all off my list. And more than that, I'm going to do everything I can to do my very best to influence you to come to know Christ in a living way like I have. That's how it's going to be from today forward. I grabbed my books, left my car. My friend sat there like stunned. What did he just say to us? I wasn't so clever about creating my redemptive moment, but my heart was in the right place. And since then, by God's grace, I've tried to refine how do you create these moments, these redemptive moments. And we know from the scriptures very clearly there are some images that are quite vivid and they're very powerful for us to hold on to. One of those images is in Matthew chapter 5, when Jesus from the very beginning made it clear to those who would be his followers that this is my desire, my intent, and he declared it openly so we couldn't miss it. That his desire would be that we would live as if we were the salt of the earth and thus never lose our saltiness and lose our value, and that we would live as those who would be called like those who are the light of the world, like a light, like a city set on a hill that cannot be hidden. And the image was clear, and I understood it, and it's something that we've hung on to for a while, and if it works and it moves your heart, then keep it. But I began to think, you know, God, I love that image, but I'd like to see it in maybe another way. Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 gives us another image that's also powerful. He talks about how we should see ourselves as literal ambassadors for Christ. That we would see ourselves as those through whom God would make his appeal, as if Jesus was speaking directly to people through us, and as ambassadors, I'm all in, I'm available, I'm on mission every single day. Those are also powerful words, and that is a powerful image. But there's one more. In 2 Corinthians chapter 4, if you read it in context, Paul makes this statement as a part of a larger issue, but here's what he says, that we should know that we have inside these jars of clay a treasure. There is this treasure in earthen vessels. That's what Corinthians says. And the point of that is that we have been given a treasure, a great investment that came into our lives via the grace and mercy of God. But now with that treasure,